Mighty God, your voice is like the crash of thunder. Your breath is like a whirlwind that breaks the mighty cedars as though they were twigs. Come to us, Holy One, when we have need of you, when we feel abandoned and alone. For you alone can comfort us and lead us through the waters of grief and loss. You alone can send us the help we need to cross over to other shores and find our way home. Give us the courage of Elisha to ask for a double portion of your spirit, for we cannot go it alone. In your faithful name we pray. Amen.
I'm light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your love. It's so amazing, and you're worthy to be praised. Father, you are our strength and our ever-present help in times of trouble. You are our protector and our provider. We stand on your promises, and you will continue to guide us when you seek you. Father, we want to ask you to bless and protect all the students and teachers who have started going back to school. Father, may you continue to help them to be cautious, to take care of their own personal hygiene, and to adjust well to the new learning style in school. Father, as more and more places will be open to the public soon, Father, we thank you that the economy will slowly be boosted once again. Father, we continue to pray for your spirit to grant us wisdom to continue to practice social distancing and take care of our hygiene at all times. Thank you for listening to our prayer. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
O Lord, you always give us the freedom to turn back, to take an easier route. But when we have the strength to carry out on and ask for a double portion of your spirit, like Elisa before us, we find blessing upon blessing. May this gift reflect our gratitude of your many gifts, especially your fruits of the spirit. May this gift lift up others in their need, that they may see their own freedom to choose life. Amen.
The scripture reading for today is taken from John chapter 17, verse 3. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. This is the word of the Lord.
A very good morning to you, dear brothers and sisters in Christ. I pray that you are keeping well during this recovering movement control order phase. A Persian legend tells us that a certain king needed a faithful servant and had to choose between two candidates for the office. He took both at fixed wages and told them to fill a basket with water from a nearby well, saying that he would come in the evening to inspect their work. After dumping one or two buckets of water into the basket, the first man said, "What is the good of doing this useless work? As soon as we pour the water in, it runs out the sides." The other answered, "But we have our wages, haven't we? The use is the master's business, not ours." The first man said, "I'm not going to do such fool's work," and throwing down his bucket, he went away. The other man continued until he had drained the well. Looking down into it, he saw something shining at the bottom. It was a diamond ring. He cried, "Now I see the use of pouring water into the basket. If the bucket had brought out the ring before the well was empty, it would have been found in the basket. Our work was not useless." There are many commands of Jesus recorded in the Bible. In the next few weeks, we will be learning the commands of Jesus and how we are to apply Jesus' commands in our life. If we have never taken the time to know what Jesus had commanded, how can we possibly be called a follower of Jesus? Learning the commands of Jesus is important because that helps us to have a better understanding on how we can live out our life being a multiplying disciple. The first command we will be learning is coming to God. Let us go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your sustaining grace and mercy on us. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. How do we define Jesus' commands? Isn't it all the teachings, warnings, conversation, or observations, commands of Jesus? Now, let us see why not all of Jesus' teachings are technically considered to be commands. Let me read to you John chapter 13, verse 27. "Then, after he had taken the morsel, Satan entered into him. Jesus said to him, 'What you are going to do, do quickly.'" Jesus said to him, "What you are going to do, do quickly." This does not mean everything we do must be done quickly. The range of meanings on the Aramaic word for the word command can include order, precept, charge, and prescription. The English definition of a command is an order or authority to command. For example, from someone in the military or royalty bringing forth a decree, or from a master to a servant, or from the king to his subjects. However, this is not the primary intent of Jesus. He was giving people the words of life. God's commands may be easily understood if we look from the point of children living in their father's house. As parents, we have expectations from our children, like brushing teeth, cleaning their room, doing homework, showing respect, going to church, and many more. These expectations, rules, or commands from parents are not meant for disciplinary, but helpful in the development of good character and preparing children to be responsible adults when they are out on their own one day. In fact, it would be irresponsible for parents not to teach their children how to manage their emotions, money, to respect authority, and to follow God's ways. We don't obey Jesus out of obligation or out of fear or guilt. We obey because we know that Jesus loves us and He has our best interests in mind at all times. God's commands are meant to help us live a happy, wholesome life that is pleasing to Him and to those around us. What we can learn today, let me read to you John chapter 17, verse 3. "And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." How does one approach God? It is impossible to answer if it had not been for the Father's only Son who showed us the way. Looking at Jesus' life, we know that nothing was more important than His relationship with His Father. They spent time in the early mornings and late into the night. They are in conversation constantly. Jesus describes His Father's kingdom, His Father's expectation of His people in His teaching. He gives us information about His Father. One of Christ's purposes in coming to earth was to reveal His Father to mankind. His commands are one of the ways we can learn about who God is and what He is like, because they reveal to us what is in His heart and reflect His nature and His character. Jesus wants us to have a healthy and vibrant relationship just like His relationship with God that He has enjoyed with His Father from the beginning. However, in order for us to experience the fullness of who God is, we must meet certain requirements. First lesson, repent. Repent. Let me read to you Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. "From that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.'" Jesus' first command is the call for repentance. Repentance is at the same time an admission of our faults and recognition of God's holiness. It accepts that God's plans for His creation are righteous, just, and perfect. And our own ways are corrupt, self-centered, and will end in destruction. God's holiness and our sins are incompatible and hostile towards each other. We can't expect to come to God on our own terms. We are only permitted into His presence on His terms. And His holiness rightfully requires repentance. Repentance is a beautiful pathway we travel that leads us back to where we should have been all along. Without repentance, we would face destruction and have no way of returning home again. True repentance brings us back in perfect relation with our Creator and allows us to begin again to experience the joy, peace, security, and contentment Jesus intended for us. Feeling sorry for our sins and failures is not enough. We have to accept the good news of Jesus' sacrificial death, bodily resurrection and reign, as true and effective for our own life. Friends, our first love response in obedience to Jesus is to repent, to reorient our lives to Jesus, His truth, His ways, and His authority. In the laboratory of the great chemist Faraday, a workman accidentally dropped a very valuable silver cup into a tank of strong acid. He and the other workmen stood over the tank, mournfully watching the quick disintegration of the cup. But Faraday, seeing what had happened, poured a chemical into the tank. The silver was precipitated to the bottom and recovered. And the shapeless mass was sent off again to a silversmith to be refashioned into its former likeness. The grace of repentance and of faith can recover what has been lost and restore it to its former usefulness and beauty. Friends, I want to ask you, have you truly repented of your sins? Have you confessed them? Have you allowed Jesus to have authority in your life? Have you examined your life from His perspective? Second lesson, come as a child. Come as a child. Let me read to you Matthew chapter 18, verses 1 to 3. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus, saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" and calling to Him a child. He put Him in the midst of them and said, "Truly, I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." The disciples waited eagerly for Jesus to name the greatest man among them. But He bypassed them completely and called a little child into their midst. Why did Jesus do that? Because the disciples were thinking only of themselves and what position they would have in His kingdom. Jesus and His kingdom are not about the ranking of men from greatest to least, where power and money enjoy more than character. No, this King and His kingdom is about changing your life and serving the Lord. Unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. You may ask, why a child? A child in the ancient world was without status and rights. Because children are humble. They are dependent. They are completely dependent on the goodwill of others to care for them. Children are teachable. Everything is new and exciting. Becoming like a child is to open our eyes again for the first time, to experience the newness of things. Children can accept things by faith that adults would otherwise struggle with, and even when things don't always make sense. These are kingdom qualities. Friends, are we dependent on God? Are we teachable? Are we willing to accept things by faith like a child? Back to the story of the Persian legend, where a Persian king was looking for a faithful man to work for him. The first man thinks the task of pouring bucketful of water from a well into a basket was fool's work, so he went away. The other man, however, diligently and faithfully completed his task and found a diamond ring. When God's blessings does not measure up with our expectations, remember to wait until the well is dry. There may be something precious at the bottom. Don't be discouraged. Only faithfulness will provide that which all Christians seek at the end of life's road. Friends, our God is calling us, come to me, to trust Him, to believe in Him, to love Him, and let Him guide us like a gracious, loving Father. We Christians must believe that our Divine Master knows what is best and obey His commands, and in due time, we will know and understand. Are you willing to go to Him? Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for teaching us the importance of following your commands. Father, forgive us. For many a time, we want to do things our way and for our convenience. Father, teach us to live by your principles and commands for our daily lives. Father, when we find it hard to follow and be obedient, encourage us and grant us your strength to stay on, because as your children, you know what is best for us. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us receive the benediction. Let us go forth from this place, secure in the knowledge of God's love. In Christ, we are forgiven. Christ lives in us, and we in Him. We are bearers of Christ's love to a broken and hungry world. This is good news indeed. Amen.